Hello, I am so excited to be back talking to people in North Carolina. 30 years ago, I actually received the Outstanding Graduate Award from the North Carolina Entomological Society, and I was on my way with the job as a new assistant professor. That didn't actually go the way I planned, but I'm really glad that it didn't because all the random paths that I ended up traveling brought me back here to you. I ended up on staff at Wired Magazine. I worked for the Washington Post. Right now, I communicate with the public full time. So I think that's why they asked me to come and talk to you about our modern media environment, which is a little weird. There's so many different channels and ways to consume media right now, it's a little overwhelming. Instagram, TikTok, Facebook, YouTube, Twitter. I mean, I could go on for quite a while. The good news is, though, we have these computers in our back pockets that can access information in seconds. So there's access to more information online than ever before in human history. And we have the technology to talk to each other across great distances, like I am tonight. In theory, we should be smarter than ever. Not always in practice, though, because people have always believed things that are weird and that aren't right. And that's not an internet thing, that's a people thing. I get school kids telling me, daddy long legs can kill you. They're the most venomous spider in the world, but their fangs are too small to bite you and break your skin. That's an oral tradition. That's not the internet. And so entomologists have always struggled to counter false information. It's just that with the internet, the volume and the nature of the information has really changed. So what is news anyway? It needs to be timely and, new. To make it interesting, writers like me look for a story structure, a narrative. We include vivid images, and a little bit of conflict is key to all good stories. So this can really work to our advantage. A great example is the coverage we got this year with periodical cicadas. They have a super weird life history. They're pretty, they're annoying and can damage trees, so there's a little bit of conflict built in, and we got amazing coverage. Part of our problem is that there is a fundamental disconnect between the structure of news and the structure of science. And so here's a periodical cicada article that has a mystery, a sense of urgency, it's got some pretty photos. How would somebody know that it's probably not legit, aside from the Daily Mail, which is a pretty good indication? This is a great example of story creation in news. The story has to have a narrative, but on the scientific side, our narrative for this was basically we have no idea what's going on with the birds. And that is not okay for a story. A story has to have a beginning, a middle, and an end. And science is all middle. We're never done. A lot of times when reporting on science goes wrong, it's because we need a narrative and rising action and conflict. And so reporters will just find it on their own. And in science, our understanding is built slowly over time. Sometimes we're wrong and we reverse ourselves. Our stories are information dense and full of jargon, and our images are usually graphs. So, yeah, reporters just filled in the blanks. And I'm using the Daily Mail as an example because, as a reporter, I like to make fun of it a lot. It is one of the top 10 news sites in the United States. Then sometimes things just get weird. A cicada landed on the president, and our secret QAnon plan is go. Because the online ecosystem meets news 24/7, really weird stuff can get promoted. And that's the internet machine needs content all the time. And so cicada nymphs come out after 17 years underground, and that is a secret message for QAnon about child trafficking. And that's because Q is the 17th letter in the alphabet. And so anything that has 17 related to it is secret comms for QAnon. What's going to make you believe secret cicada messages? It is not the data. It is what you're already feeling. And that's how all of our news stories are interpreted. It's not how well written it is or how factual it is. It's does it already kind of fit in what I already believe? And so the best news is the news that you're most comfortable with. A great example is what happens when there is a snow forecast in North Carolina. It doesn't matter that the meteorologist or the data says that you will not be trapped in your house and have to eat your pets in some sort of weird dinner party scenario. The stores are going to get cleared out. And that's because we experience the world through a mind and a meat suit body that's operating on evolutionary hardware that's millions of years old. I mean, you think Windows 10 was bad? Our brain software is from the Paleolithic. The limbic system is always going to win. We're social animals. We run on emotion and group dynamics. And It seems like we can fix this, right? It's a basic transaction. New input, better output. It's called the deficit model, and it doesn't work. Unfortunately, decades of educational and social research show that it doesn't work, because humans aren't Vulcans. We've got an internet that can deliver answers to every question in seconds. So if people believe things that are weird, it's usually for another reason besides just lack of information. And it's not that people's heads are empty and that there's a hole in their understanding that we have to fill with facts. It's that their heads are already full of stuff. And you're never really having a conversation about just insects or just bees or just facts. Because we're social animals, social interactions are a primary way of validating information. And even in the online era, the most trusted information is going to come from our friends and family. Is this a good face wash? Are bees going to go extinct? So, sure, social media and the internet makes our social groups bigger, but it also repeats messages over and over and over, and we know from research repetition increases belief. So when a message is repeated over and over, like bees are going extinct, it seems more real and truthy. And if you're talking to someone and they ask you, are the bees dying? And you answer, well, actually, it's just some bee species. And actually, bees aren't native to the United States. And actually, it's complicated like that. And here's a graph, and also varroa mite. I mean, it's not going to go well. The real deficit in modern life is time and attention. How much of your attention are you really giving to this talk? 50%? 70%? I will take 70%. I'm very pleased with that. Email is popping up notifications on your desktop. Someone's texting you on your phone. Your kids need help with homework. And it's kind of late, but maybe you can have one more cup of coffee, maybe? The only thing that gets our full attention now is what is on fire. We don't have time to make careful, reasoned decisions every day. As scientists, our training puts us at a disadvantage. We're not supposed to be emotional, but emotions and feelings are the most important thing about humans and learning and memory. Brown recluses are not going on a rampage across the United States, killing people right and left. But you probably know somebody who's convinced that their cousin's friend's grandma lost a toe because of a recluse bite. Fear is a primal emotion, and our brains are hardwired to pay special attention to threats. Our brains are more likely to go, yikes, I better watch out for brown recluses, than to remember, oh, the geographic area that a brown recluse occurs in is really not here in North Carolina. So once somebody feels a really strong emotion and they've activated their emotions, it's really difficult to change that. And you absolutely cannot change anyone's emotions by telling them you shouldn't feel that way. Also, that's an important relationship tip, not just PsyCon. The internet is a public utility, but it all runs on for-profit systems. And the secret sauce to internet success is a huge marketing industry that understands our brains still run on outdated emotional software. Billions of dollars each year go into researching how to make you click on things. There's a scientific data-backed reason headlines look like they do. When we're putting out our entomological information, we're up against thousands of data and software engineers that also have personalized data that tells them exactly how to best manipulate you and to make your Paleolithic brain go, ooh, and click on things. I thought using that research, I'd show you an example of a perfect entomological clickbait headline. 5 weird links between toilet paper, insects, and Norse mythology. Would you click it? It's not clickbait. It is emotional engineering with very detailed data science. This headline works because it taps into things our brains are hardwired to notice. Numbers. We know that putting a number in a headline increases clicks by up to 20%. Unexpected juxtapositions. It activates our surprise and curiosity, which is pretty darn human. Specific audience targeting. So entomologists, insects, butts, toilet paper, you can't go wrong with butts, and hot Scandinavian gods, which is to say sex, which is the other thing you can't really go wrong with. So headlines look the way they do because of data. And why am I making headlines a big emphasis? Because again, we're busy. Headlines are the first thing you see on social media and search engines, and people scan quickly. Starting the title of a video or publication with how-to is going to be backed up with traffic data. What do you Google? How to do something? 10 simple tricks to get rid of stink bugs. Surprise! Dragonfly nymphs are jet-propelled through their anus. An explainer, the why questions. Why do stink bugs stink? Why do spiders come in my house? And things that are time-sensitive. So something that's especially relevant in this time period, like army worms are coming for your lawn. And debunker, you can write, but that's a whole big topic, and I'm going to just kind of guide over that. The issue is, you know, here we are, we're putting out our content, but algorithms are what's in charge of what we see online, not people. And so the more people search for things, the more Google and others show it to them, because it's what people are interested in, right? Even if it's a terrible idea. Because again, it's about profit, not accuracy. When it's all about the clicks, and when all engagement is the same, that's going to let misinformation be amplified and some other really harmful stuff be amplified. It doesn't matter if it's right or it's accurate or it's good, just that people click. And it's the info that generates the emotions that spreads, not the facts. In this case, if the emotion is, hey, my dad was totally right, you can kill fire ants with grits, that's going to get shared. So to kind of circle back and rephrase my title, now that I've kind of taken a quick tour of what's happening on the news side of the house, should extension entomology be TikToking and meme-making and using clickbait headlines? And I think more importantly, if you did that, would you still have a job? Would that be accepted as professional behavior? Because we are required to do the stuff we've always done in extension, put out really clear research answers to insect problems. But now we also need to keep pace with all of these new ways to reach people and to counter some really not great information that they're getting online. So how do we do that? And I think what we need to do is to go on the offensive, not the defensive, and use the tools that popular media has developed to make our information more attractive to readers. For a lot of scientists, marketing is not comfortable. I mean, hype and clickbait are not a thing that we do. But we have lots of evidence that we can be competitive. We have amazing animals to talk about and really interesting information. This is a great example of Dr. Adrian Smith right here from North Carolina, makes amazing videos. He just had a paper come out last week about how scientists appearing in videos affects the trustworthiness of a message. And here's a super cool collaboration earlier this year Adrian did with Zay Frank. This was a brilliant strategic partnership with someone who has a massive online audience already developed. This video has been out for 6 months. It's already getting close to 4 million views. So we can compete, but we just have to take chances with new ways of sharing information. And one of the ways to do that is to have some partnerships. So partnerships also means that you can target audiences a little easier. Instead of having to spend time and energy on recruiting people for bug stuff, we can tap into an existing community. So extension has always worked through partnerships. That's pretty normal. And what I've got here is a picture from a really interesting partnership that I've done over the last 10 years. I've gone to science fiction conventions. Dragon Con, for example, normally has at least 70,000 people each year visit. So here's a great place where by basically crashing somebody else's party, we can have a huge audience. That's how you build trust. You go to their space, say, look, I'm part of you. I'm one of your social groups. Look for a huge audience that someone else has already organized for you so you can crash their party. To partner effectively with the media, you need images. Every story online needs images. The web is a visual medium. Images with humans are shared at 3 times the rate of just images with insects or non-human animals. Don't publish a web page anywhere if it doesn't have a bunch of photos on it. And give your photos away for free if you can. This photo is from the Washington Department of Agriculture, who's done an amazing job making all of their photos of the giant hornet nest removals Creative Commons or public domain. So as a reporter, all I have to do is grab the photo and run. The other really great thing we can do is feed the content machine. News needs new content all the time, 24/7. So give really good quality of content away. It'll get picked up. This is an example from NC State. Matt Bertone wrote this awesome article about killing spiders in your house 3 years ago. 3 years ago, it's still being republished today. The thing is, here is quality content. Because it was licensed Creative Commons, it was free for anyone to republish and use. When you give content away for free and still licensed, it gets picked up and spread all over. So at this point, I would say easily there's at least 5 million shares, and I would guess it is considerably higher than that. But when you give things away Creative Commons, it also means you give up some control. So you don't always have control over where things appear and what images are used. I'm not entirely sure I would have picked that one on the right there, but you know, on the other hand, it got read. Giving things away for free and unlicensed is a really hard sell for universities. They want everything branded and they want control. The other really useful thing you can do is make sure that your information tells a story and your story has people in it. People are more interesting than insects or nature. And this is a great example that I love. It's called The Tree Coroners. It's CSI for trees. I mean, who isn't going to pick that up? This is really a story about bark beetles. But honestly, CSI for trees is a little more engaging for most folks. When we forget to include people in our research stories, we're leaving out the most important part for non-scientists. In our Paleolithic brain, stories are a privileged cognitive pathway. They stick. Stories with more details are believed more and are more persuasive. If you've ever cried over a novel or a movie, you know how easily our emotions are activated by stories. And so when we're just sticking to the facts, we actually lose a really important tool because facts just don't resonate the same way a story will. The way that we tell our stories and the way that we structure our publications, we can also borrow a few things, in this case, Daily Mail again. The Daily Mail and a lot of other places have switched to this format where they have the main points of a story are bulleted. That makes it super easy for a busy person to scan and see, oh, is this article what I want? What if some of our information dense extension bulletins had bullets at the top to let somebody scan it quickly and find out if that's what they want? We don't have access to all the data that the big tech giants do, but we can still target audiences in the way that we write our information. Once you have a story, what's the hook? What's going to grab somebody's attention? Fatal farts. That's a hook. And we can get a little obsessed with accuracy. What our goal is here is information sharing. Jargon and terminology can be an obstacle to the goal. And I will fight anybody who says what I do is dumbing down. It is not. What it is translation. It is taking the ideas in the top document and translating it to something that is interesting to the general public. And sometimes in our obsession with facts, we can make people feel like they aren't really being listened to. Well, actually, is a type of correctile dysfunction. It stops dialogue. You have to listen to get people to engage with you. And if somebody says something weird, ask them why. Ask them, why do you feel that way? Engage the emotions. Tell them what they feel is reasonable. I can totally see why you would have some questions about GMO crops. That's how you build trust. And that's how you use the power of emotions to help our Paleolithic brains make some connections. Trying new things is hard, but we're scientists. We can totally do this. I would absolutely love to get super nerdy about web analytics and big data, but I don't think anybody has time for that. So I will recommend that you check out these papers for more ideas about how to train extension educators, stories about how people learn, and then my article about alternative facts. Thank you so much for inviting me to talk to the Entomological Society.